Our world is constantly evolving. As time moves forward, things change, which is why it's important to stay informed. Throughout the year, there are dozens of professionals that share their expertise with the community through lectures sponsored by local government agencies and area not-for-profits. And each month, SLCTV will feature one of these visiting professors as they discuss the latest current events. So grab a notebook and pull up a chair, because the lecture hall is about to begin.
Thank you all for coming tonight. My name is Emily, and I'm with the Indian River Lagoon Aquatic Preserves Office, and that is under DEP, the Department of Environmental Protection. Who here has heard of the Department of Environmental Protection? Okay, some of you haven't. So the DEP runs several different programs in the state parks, air and water regulation, and then the Aquatic Preserves Office. So we are under the Aquatic Preserves Office, the Florida Coastal Office. And the Florida Coastal Office manages a lot of acres of submerged lands, and these are important submerged lands around the state. And also in coordination with NOAA, three estuarine research reserves, Florida Keys National Marine Sanctuary, and the Coral Reef Conservation Program. So a lot of great programs around the state. And here's a nice map showing all the different 41 aquatic reserves around Florida. We've got the, doesn't work. Oh, it's okay.
A point.
So, as you can see, the Indian River Lagoon over here, Mosquito Lagoon, all the way down to Loxahatchee River, Lake Worth Creek, is what our office manages. And that is a total of around 95,000 acres in the seven aquatic preserves that we manage. And the North Fork of the St. Lucie River is one of our aquatic preserves. So it's pretty special. We have the Oxbow here, so it's a nice connection here. And I just threw a slide in about the Oxbow. All of you obviously know about the Oxbow, but this is a presentation about a project between the two of us, so I wanted to throw their beautiful logo in there as well. Okay, so I will go over general information first about microplastics and plastics in general, and if anyone has any questions, feel free to ask. And then I will go into the project after that. So starting with microplastics, what are they? They're very small plastics with an upper size limit of 5 millimeters. And there's different categories or different types of microplastics. And we have polyethylene, you've probably heard of plastic bags and things like that, bottles, polystyrene, food containers, nylon, polypropylene, fabrics, like a lot of the clothing we wear, fibers in our fleece jackets or different types of shirts and pants, water pipes, polyvinyl chloride. Some of those can be broken down into secondary microplastics, but I'll talk about that in a second. We have nurdles, which are pre-production resin pellets, so they're produced to be small pieces of plastic. They're used as fillers, like in Beanie Babies or pillows, those creepy little pillows you get for the airplane, things like that. So, yeah. Cat toys, dog toys, which are a disaster. Don't do that, because they're all over my house. And microbeads, they are in personal care products. You wouldn't even really imagine, but they are. They're in face washes, toothpaste, soaps, things like that. And I don't know exactly which, if it went through. I know that there were some regulations with microbeads in certain products recently. And there's some pictures there. So primary microplastics are what I was explaining that are, you know, they're produced to be small. They're small already, so they're in their initial stage, like the microbeads. That are in, say, face wash or the annoying little pellets in your dog's toys. And then there's secondary microplastics. These are plastics that are the result of the degradation of primary plastics or bigger pieces of plastic. And here are some examples. These are ones found in the lagoon, actually. Some examples here, a filament, a fragment, and a film. Kind of hard to see. So let's move back a little bit. We'll talk about plastics in general, so not just small ones, but big ones. Forgive me, I'm going to a few notes on this one, so I might read some notes, because there's some interesting facts. So in the 1970s, that was when the first reports of plastics were being found in the marine environment. Not a huge outcry, just kind of mentioned. It was in the news a little bit. But in the 1990s and 2000s, it kind of inspired research and raised concern of plastics in the marine environment, raising more public concern. A lot of this had to do with pictures of animals with plastic wrapped around their necks, birds cut open, turtles that have plastic in their stomachs. So that really raised the public's concern a bit more. Plastics, do people know exactly what plastics are? Like, what is plastic?
Hydrocarbon chains.
So they're a wide array of semi-synthetic or synthetic organic solids that are molded or transformed into products. And their ease of use and availability of raw materials and the flexibility for their use makes them very popular. Also, less expensive to use than other materials. And they've taken the place of more traditional things like wood, glass, metal, paper, ceramics, leather, things like that. Plastic production is applicable to many industries due to its versatile properties, and it has high heat and pressure resistance too. So it's widely used, so that's why we see a lot of it. So 275 million metric tons of plastic were generated in 192 coastal countries in 2010. And that equals around 5 grocery bags, plastic grocery bags, plastic for every foot of shoreline in the countries that were studied, so in that study. So that's a lot of plastic. Just another interesting fact, 32 million metric tons of plastic waste generated in the US alone in 2012. And that was a report done by the EPA. And I just had to include, I was doing a little research, the Grand View Research, they do a lot of global research of the markets. And the global plastic market is expected to reach $654.38 billion by 2020. So we're not slowing down with our plastic production. Other findings suggest, by this Grand View Research, that global plastics demand was, well, it was 233.75 million tons in 2013, and is expected to reach 334.83 million tons by 2020. That's a lot of plastic. So there's just different markets around the world that are growing with plastic, and it has to do with automotive and just product sales. So real interesting stuff. And you can see down here, it's just the global demand and the plastic production just growing. So that's where our microplastics are coming from. So why do we care about this? Why do we care about plastics in the environment? There's several kind of key things here. We keep finding them in the environment, and they seem to be increasing in abundance. They do not biodegrade. They may break down, but they don't ever go away. They absorb toxins, so that has implications for different things, whether it be for our health or for the health of animals or ecosystems. They are eaten by marine life, and like I said, there may be potential human impacts. And there are additives and toxins used in the manufacturing of plastics, and these can leach out. They can leach into animal tissues. So these are just some of the concerns. And that's a really sad picture of the turtle eating plastic. So microplastics and the environment. So if they're in the environment, what does this mean? And then other questions, like how do they get there? Where are they? So how do they get there? Does anyone have a guess what the number one way in which microplastics get to the marine environment or get into our waterways? Does anyone have an idea, a guess?
Litter, trash,
good guesses. So wastewater treatment plants and runoff, because a lot of the plastics, microplastics occur from us, from our everyday use, and it gets, it's in the wastewater, and they're too small to be filtered out in the wastewater treatment plants, so they're effluent and they get washed out. So they're in our systems, in our water systems. For example, the personal care products, the fibers in clothing, that's the big one. They're finding most of the microplastics, at least some of the studies have shown that large quantities of these microplastics are fibers from clothing, from the clothing that we wear. So when we wash that clothing, thousands of pieces of plastic come off the clothing. I know, it makes you feel so helpless, sorry. But yeah, it's crazy. So that study in 2001 investigated wastewater treatment plants and microplastics. And they found 100 microplastic fibers were present in 1 liter of wastewater. So that was averaging 1,900 fibers can be discarded in by one synthetic garment. And then that study with the wastewater they were relating to the treatment plants was mostly the fiber. So quite interesting. But at this point, there's not a lot of research focusing on or kind of. It's brand new, is what I'm trying to say. So there's not a lot of research looking at exactly what this is going to mean. So there's a lot of discovery right now. So that's why it's kind of a cool time to have a project. But you know, questions like, can microplastics bioaccumulate in the food chain? We don't know yet. And what are the potential risks, if there are, to us? We eat a lot of animals that eat microplastics. And if microplastics are in the base of the food chain, say they're in algae, in which they have found, other things eat that, so our plankton. They also look like little things that fish or other animals might want to eat. So, you know, we could be eating these plastics. And then other questions like, how do microplastics impact filter feeders? We love oysters. So how do they impact oysters? There's been some studies on that, and I'll touch on that in a second. So I did a little research and I cut and pasted some titles to studies because just to show you what people are looking at now, and some of them were very surprising to me. So I'll read them out. They're a little small. Sorry about that. Microplastic pollution in deep sea sediments. So they were finding microplastics in deep sea sediments. Another place you wouldn't think. High levels of microplastic pollution in a large remote mountain lake. Interesting. And this one is ingestion and transfer of microplastics in the plankton food web. So that's kind of what we were talking about there. That's super interesting. And then microplastic pollution in the surface waters of the Laurentian Great Lakes. So it seemed to be everywhere. So not just, you know, in our estuary here or open ocean, but lots of interesting ecosystems. And then in terms of animals, I just highlighted some interesting parts of the abstracts in these studies. So this one, microplastics ingestion by a deep oceanic cetacean, so the true-beaked whale. So this study I just highlighted here, the larger of the marine organisms or microplastics were identified throughout the digestive tract of these whales. And both adult females had macroplastics in their stomachs as well. So this is this was the first study to identify microplastics in a whale. So interesting. Yeah, it's pretty depressing. And then this one was assessing microplastics and the toxicity to sea urchins. So people are getting into the impacts here. They found plastic pellets act as a vector of additives and organic pollutants to the water column. And they leached chemicals from pellets, reduced viability of the sea urchin larvae, so they're impacting the sea urchin's reproduction. So, interesting. And then this one, you know, we're being very interested in oysters here in the Indian River Lagoon. This study, I printed it out, I have the longer copy of it, looked at the impacts of microplastics on oysters, and here they have highlighted female oysters exposed to microplastics made 38% fewer eggs, and males made sperm that was 23% slower. And then there's other findings. So they were really pinpointing just kind of slower reproductive rates. So interesting. So leading into what we can do about it and what's being done, and the Florida Microplastics Awareness Project is kind of the mecca right now in Florida in terms of wonderful information on microplastics. It is a citizen science program, and it is started being funded in 2015 by an outreach and education grant from NOAA's Marine Debris program. So it is the base of it is a citizen science program. It is headed up by the IFAS lab, and it is great. This website has all the information you could possibly want, and they really want people around the state to develop their own citizen science programs based on microplastics. With the idea that, you know, starting small, it just started with a few people sampling, people are finding microplastics all over Florida. So it's kind of like, oh gosh, let's find more. Let's see what's going on. So it's growing. They had some interesting, they have nice summaries here of their facts every once in a while. They compile pledges, and I'll talk about those in a second. And 89% of the samples here, they brought together, contained at least one piece of plastic. And these are of the people that submitted their data. So it's a great website, has a lot of information. And in terms of St. Lucie County, I just had this up because I presented in St. Lucie County at the Manatee Center about this. It looks like there's a lot of samples, and those are one-time samples, which is great. But you'll notice, I mean, this is pretty zoomed out. There's a lot of gaps. So here we have Fort Pierce. These two little guys right there are the North Fork. There's been two samples taken. Those were me. Those were us. And then looking over here, there they are again. Actually, sorry, there was three samples. The whole North Fork, you know, there's a lot of gaps in information and samples. And then looking here at different sections of the Indian River Lagoon where our office has grabbed some samples. And these are just kind of baseline samples that we took with an intern just to see, you know, what do we have microplastics? What are we looking at? And get the ball rolling. And this was last fall. And for example, like this is near Harbor Branch up here. This is the North Fork here. And this is in Fort Pierce. All of our samples had microplastics in them. And these are some examples here. There, you can see them circled. All right, quiz. Can anyone tell me what that last one is? There you go, yeah. And this one looks like a fragment. Sometimes it's hard. So there's a lot of information on the website of how to determine whether it's plastic or it's a organic piece of something, algae or something like that. So it can be tricky. So moving forward, how can we advance microplastics in this area? What can we do? Because we really want to know more and we want to get this going. So we can establish a microplastic citizen science program. And we're trying to do that. We want to do a nice citizen science program in collaboration with the Oxbow. So it would be a great Indian River Lagoon Aquatic Preserves and St. Lucie County Oxbow project here at the Oxbow. We'd like to recruit microplastics volunteers, kind of have a microplastics team, which is the idea. And that team would develop their own specific research goals or ideas or things. You know, people might have questions of their own. So to kind of have the team put together their goals and objectives and design the project. So possible questions, I mean, these were just ideas, like what might we ask, what might we want to look at? What types of plastics are in our waterways? I mean, we could be looking at canals, we could be looking at different parts of the North Fork, or maybe some people live somewhere else on the Indian River Lagoon and want to sample near their home, so pretty flexible. But what type of plastics do we have? Which water bodies have the most? Are there more microplastics in the water after rain events? Runoff, things like that, maybe strategic locations. How do sample locations compare with amount and types? These are just, research ideas. So there's many different questions that we could ask, so it gets kind of exciting. To me, sorry, very dorky. Excites me, it's very nice. Love research. So the process is actually really easy, and that's what makes it a great thing. It's a great project for younger kids to adults. The process is simple. There's specific Nalgene bottles. You go grab a water sample with a bottle like that, not really hard. Bring it back to the lab, and it can sit for a long time. It's actually better if it sits because some of the stuff, the sand and everything, or things that'll get in your way will sink to the bottom. And then you get back to the lab and you filter it. That's a hand pump. We have automatic ones. And there's an example over there. And then you let the filters dry for a while because it sucks the water down and you have everything on that little filter. So you let it dry for a day. I think a day was about it. And then you can put them under the microscope and you count your microplastics. You identify and count. And that's probably the harder part. So it's actually a gridded filter, so you can kind of identify and circle things. So not too hard. And then, in addition to filling out your own data sheet or whatever we, you know, come up with our own questions, we can upload the data to the Florida Microplastics Awareness Project because they have an online form. So all your data gets uploaded to their map for everybody to see. So it's kind of a, you know, you have the big state thing going on. Here are some examples of what you might see in a microscope. Fiber, fragment, things like that. So I just wanted to show you the data sheet online and how simple it is. It's basically just time, you know, when you took the sample, where you took the sample, your name, latitude and longitude, how many fibers, how many fragments, how many microbeads, and then comments and the name. So it's quite simple. It just takes a few minutes. And then they're very quick with adding that data, so you can go on the map and see where you sampled. So there's different ways to get involved. Maybe you don't want to be on the microplastics team, but that is a great way to get involved, for sure. The Florida Microplastics Awareness Project has a Facebook. If you're curious about how you may be impacting the environment with plastics, you can change your habits or look up the products you're using. There's a great website, the Household Products website, that tells you which ones contain plastic. And then you can also share your knowledge with other people, because I feel like sometimes you don't, you know, it's just a learning process. We don't know. I don't know. I learn things every time I read more about this. So, and I did bring pledges, and I think they're really cool because maybe you don't necessarily want to take the pledge, but it shows you ways in which you can cut down on your plastic use. So I brought some of those and some information packets, but I noticed, Aaron, you have those over there already. Looks great. We have a nice microplastics table over here. Yeah. Let's see. So, I didn't mean to breeze through, but if anyone has any questions, I figured we could discuss things as well. And there are the emails, and I know Aaron mentioned if you were curious or interested in getting involved, there's a sign-up sheet.